NX sketching is fundamental to many feature types, so it is extremely important to understand it well. This video shows the sketching procedure that will lead to good sketching practices. The steps are listed here. 1. Establish the sketch plane and datums. 2. Sketch important reference lines. 3. Sketch the rough shape. 4. Constrain to the datum axes. 5. Add geometric constraints. 6. Add driving dimensions. 7. Modify dimension values to test the design intent. Not every step is required for every sketch, and they don't necessarily have to be in this exact order. Let's demonstrate this procedure by modeling this electrical outlet cover. The standard dimensions can be found on the internet from the National Electrical Manufacturers Association. In this model, we will create 3 sketches, and we will go through the procedure 3 times. We will create other features to complete the part, but the focus of this video is on the sketch procedure. Let's first look at part symmetry and function. Because the cover has 2 planes of symmetry, let's locate the datum coordinate system at the intersection of the 2 planes. Let's use the back face as the 3rd plane because this is the face where the cover rests flush against the wall. Okay, let's start with an empty part and create metadata according to our class standards. The first sketch is the outer shape of the cover. Step 1 is to select the plane. Let's create the first sketch on the YZ plane of the datum coordinate system. It doesn't really matter, but this is convenient because Z is up on the screen by default. We skip step 2 because we won't use any reference lines in this sketch. For step 3, let's sketch a rectangle. Don't waste time trying to create it to the exact size. Notice that there are 4 automatically created dimensions. Basically, ignore these and watch them go away as we add constraints. Step 4, constrain the midpoint of each side to the datum coordinate system origin. Notice how 2 of the automatically created dimensions are deleted. Skip step 5 because we don't need any additional geometric constraints other than constraining to the origin. Remember that some geometric constraints, such as perpendicular and vertical, have already automatically been captured as we sketch the rectangle. Step 6 is to add driving dimensions. We can either create dimensions or just edit the existing auto-created dimensions to convert them to driving dimensions. At this point, the sketch is fully constrained without any leftover auto-created dimensions. Step 7 is to set the dimensions to the desired values and test the design intent by varying the values. I like to use the command Edit Sketch Parameters because it lets me dynamically drag each dimension to see how the sketch moves. This is the most important step, to check that as we change the dimension values, the sketch moves according to our design intent. In this case, notice how symmetry is maintained. Let's finish this sketch and start a second sketch for the shape of the cutouts for the electrical outlet. For step 1, let's create the second sketch on the same YZ plane. Step 2, this time let's sketch a vertical line to represent the center-to-center distance. Convert this line to a reference curve because it will not be part of the extruded shape. This is out of order, but step 4 is to constrain this line to the datum coordinate system. Let's constrain the midpoint to the origin, and then constrain the line coincident with the z-axis. Step 3 is to sketch the rough shape. We start with a circle at the top end of the reference line. Edit the auto-created diameter to the desired value. Let's sketch a rectangle with opposite corners on the circle. One way to create geometric constraints is to drag the curves until they snap. Let's drag one of the other corners to create a geometric constraint for that corner to lie also on the circle. The two vertical lines are not needed in the final shape we're going to extrude, but instead of deleting or trimming them, let's convert them to reference curves, because they help constrain the other two lines. Next, let's trim away the top and bottom of the circle. Oops, I didn't mean to do that. Let me undo and try that again. Step 5, let's create a geometric constraint by mirroring these curves. Step 6 is to add driving dimensions. We need a vertical dimension here. Now the sketch is fully constrained with no auto-created dimensions. Step 7, let's test the design intent the same as we did before. We can wiggle each of the three driving dimensions to see that the sketch remains symmetric. Finish the sketch. Next, we extrude the outer sketch 5.5 millimeters. Let's add an edge blend to all the edges of the front face using a radius of 5 millimeters. Looking at the back side, we shell the part to add thickness to every face except the back face, which is deleted. Now let's extrude the cutout through the part using the through all option and the Boolean subtract option. The model is now taking shape. Let's create a countersunk hole using a sketch to position the point. For this third sketch, step 1 is to sketch on the front face. We sketch on the front face because we want to create a point on the face which indicates the location of the hole, and it also indicates the side with the countersink. This sketch is actually quite simple. All we do is create a point by projecting the origin to the sketch plane. This completes all the steps of the sketch because the point is constrained to the datum and there are no driving dimensions. Finish the sketch like we did with the other sketches. Now use the hole command to create a countersunk hole with the given diameters and countersink angle. We don't need the sketches anymore, so let's hide them. The last step is to add a 1.5 millimeter edge blend to these sharp edges. Select these edges using the tangent curve option because there is actually a curve and a straight line segment on each one of them. That finishes the part model. Let's review the features we created in the part navigator. These are the datum coordinate system, two sketches, an extrude of the outer rectangle, an edge blend, a shell feature, an extrude where we made the cutouts, a sketch with one point, and lastly, an edge blend. Let's not forget to save our model. To prove that all our sketches are fully constrained without any auto-created dimensions, we can run checkmate. We select the two sketch tests and then run these tests. The results show that all the sketches pass both tests. Of course, these tests only show that the sketches are fully constrained. These tests don't know if the sketch contains your design intent. Review the 7 steps we use to create each sketch. The most important is the last step to test the design intent. Every sketch should be fully constrained without any auto-created dimensions, and you should be able to vary every dimension and watch the sketch wiggle as you expect. If you have any remaining auto-created dimensions that you don't understand, edit them and see what wiggles. These auto-created dimensions usually indicate that you have forgotten some constraint or dimension. In summary, the order of the steps is not as important as ending up with a fully constrained sketch and testing to make sure that it captures your desired design intent. Here's one more bonus. We have created good sketches for the outlet cover, but is everything else in this part model okay? Let's run another check to analyze the manufacturability of the pockets. This part fails this test because we have an added draft. Let's add a two degree draft angle to each of the extruded features and run the tests again. This time, all the tests pass.